celebration.
Good morning.
My name is Holly Pills. We are having a, in case this is your first time here, we are having a welcome home celebration this morning. If this is your first time, this is welcome home. Welcome to your home. And this is my church home, and the moment I walked in the door, I knew I was home. Our pastor, Jorene Taylor Swift, has been on sabbatical for the last 6 months, and we are so grateful that we were so grateful to be blessed by Pastor David Grable during that time. He made sure we knew we were loved.
Amen.
I would like to invite everyone to the fellowship hall after the worship service this morning for a heartfelt homecoming reception to visit with Pastor, and we will have some light bites for everyone to enjoy. Now, with no further ado, please welcome home Jorene Taylor Swift.
This church has a way of grabbing our hearts and not letting go, and it's so good to be back with you. We have friends from afar who have come to celebration. I'm trying to say they came just because it was my first Sunday back, but I know it's not true. And they have come from afar. Where are Laura and Diane? Oh, there you are. Stand up. They have come from Ecuador. So I think they get the prize for their assistance there. Most of you know that I spent my sabbatical in California. I did have a child in Florida, so I could have gone there. So in California, and I was around my grandchildren, 17, 15, and 11. They do their very best to keep me up to date on the latest fashion and the latest vernacular. And so this morning, in honor of them, I'm wearing my Stan Smith shoes, and they are fire. So, if you're first time this year with us, will you please fill out the yellow card in the pew rack in front of you? It will give us a record of your visit. We want to know that you are here. And then you can put it in the offering plate when it is passed later in the service. Some of you began visiting while I was away. I would like to meet you and get to know you, so you'll be hearing from me in the next 2 weeks so that we can be, plan a time to meet for coffee or Coke or whatever you like to drink, and so that I can meet you. Yesterday was PB&J Day and celebration. We need a drum, always. You made 1,685 sandwiches. You brought 1,217 snacks and 1,776 bottles of water. All of this. All of this to help people who seek shelter at the Presbyterian Night Shelter. Don't forget to put August 12th, that's right, the services auction, right? On your calendar, it will be the services auction night, and if you have a service you want to donate, the ushers have forms that you can fill out and return to the church office. Today's text, I want to remind you, if you are interested in becoming a member of Celebration, or if you just want to get to know more about the church, on August the 6th, after worship in Fellowship Hall, we will have a new member class. And that doesn't mean you have to commit to anything before you come to the class. Just come and hear about Celebration. When the red book is passed, if you will write your name and put new member, that way we will know to order a lunch for you. So it's really important. Today's text for the sermon is from Genesis. And it's going to be the beginning of a series of sermons on the Old Testament. It's always a temptation, at least for me, to preach from the New Testament, to preach the gospel lesson. And yet we find in the Old Testament that there are real life stories that give us strength and an understanding of the big questions of life. So from now through the end of August, we will be in Genesis, and I think the last Sunday is in Exodus. I kept up with you while I was gone, celebration, and you have been doing such a wonderful job. You've been doing good work, participating in so many pride activities during June, taking the lead in advocacy issues within the LGBTQ community and our community at large. And that's just to name a few of the things that you did while I was gone. But you continued being the church. And I'm thankful for each of you. And I hope that you will stay for the reception afterwards so I get to give you a hug and talk to you for a bit. Now, please stand and greet those around you, giving them the peace of Christ.
Joys and our sorrows. Make us ready to become stronger witnesses for your love as we receive your word and find our spirits and lives healed. Amen. Amen.
This morning, as we begin our worship and song together, I'd like to say a special announcement that the music selected this morning are chosen to honor Jorene Taylor Swift, pieces that are near and dear to her heart, and a way for us to worship God together in a meaningful way. I invite you to stand as you are able as we begin worshiping together. This morning's opening song is The Gift of Love. I want to encourage you to really listen to the text of this beautiful hymn. If you're following along in the hymnal, it's page 526. Again, the lyrics. projected above, and if you'd like to follow along in your red hymnal, page 526, The Gift of Love.
I have sworn, and I fully mean, I will keep your righteous rules. I have been suffering so much. Lord, make me live again according to your promise. Please, Lord, accept my spontaneous gifts of praise. Teach me your rules. Though my life is constantly in danger, I won't forget your instruction. Though the wicked have set a trap for me, I won't stray from your precepts. Your laws are my possession forever, because they are my heart's joy. I have decided to keep your statutes forever, every last one. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
This morning and for the next few weeks, our prayer song will be "Surely the Presence of the Lord is in This Place." I invite you to sing along with the choir as we center ourselves for prayer.
I wanted to use this pulpit this morning because I wanted to be closer to you this day. And it won't be this way all the time from now on. As we pray this morning, when you hear me say, This is our prayer. Please respond. Lord, hear our prayer. Please pray with me. God of all, we lift our prayers to you this day, knowing that you love us and you will not abandon us. We pray to feel your presence and to be upheld by your Spirit. We pray this day for all your children who live in faraway places touched by war and unrest. May they feel your presence. This is our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for people who, in the midst of this heat wave, have no escape, no air conditioning, and little water. We pray for those who must evacuate their homes because of fires, and people who have lost their homes because of flooding. This is our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for children, teachers, and staff who will soon return to school. We know that many of them are fearful and anxious. Help us love them and give us the courage to stand up for them by not settling for the status quo. This is our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray this day for those in our church who find no peace because of struggles with physical, emotional, and spiritual illness. We pray this day especially for David Brock, Diane Peterson, John Mark Weathering, Kathy and Rosemary Mazzone, Lisa Matthews, Ricardo Riley, Scott Green, Terry Pruitt, Julia Thieves and her family in the loss of her brother-in-law Jerry, Lynette Bushnell and family in the loss of her son Christopher. Grant them strength, O Lord. This is our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayers.
We pray for people everywhere who have been marginalized. Give us the courage to stand in solidarity with them. This is our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for our church, celebration that has been home to so many who have come before us and is home for us today. Thank you, O God, for being a God of homecoming. We give you thanks for this table, the cup and bread that remind us of your presence with us and your love. This is our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayer.
God of love and life, we pray for courage to be your people. We give you thanks for calling us to serve you in this time and in this place. This is our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And now we sing together the prayer that Jesus taught the disciples.
Thank you.
A reading from Genesis. Jacob left Beersheba and set out for Haran. He reached a certain place and spent the night there. When the sun had set, he took one of the stones at that place and put it near his head. Then he lay down there. He dreamed and saw a raised staircase, its foundation on the earth and its top touching the sky. And God's messengers were ascending and descending on it. Suddenly, the Lord was standing on it and saying, "I am the Lord, the God of your father Abraham, and the God of Isaac. I will give you and your descendants the land on which you are lying. Your descendants will become like the dust of the earth. You will spread out to the west, east, north, and south. Every family on earth will be blessed because of you and your descendants. I am with you now. I will protect you everywhere you go, and I will bring you back to this land. I will not leave you until I have done everything that I have promised you." When Jacob woke from his sleep, he thought to himself, "The Lord is definitely in this place, but I didn't know it." He was terrified and thought, "This sacred place is awesome. It's none other than God's house and the entrance to heaven." After Jacob got up early in the morning, he took the stone that he had put near his head, set it up as a sacred pillar, and poured oil on the top of it. He named that sacred place Bethel. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
hallway, you may see that. What a way to be welcomed home, right? It is just, that was amazing. This is more emotional than I thought it would be. The Bible is a love story. It is the story of God's love for us, God's presence with us. Story after story from Genesis to Revelation tell us that no matter what happened, God was in the midst of it. God is Emmanuel, God with us. While I was away, there were miles and miles between us, but we were still connected because of God's love. Our scripture from Genesis 28 tells a story. Now, many of you know this story. It is the story of Jacob and Esau. It is a plot line that you might find on a soap opera or in the movies. Abraham's son Isaac and his wife Rebekah don't have any children. And they ask God about this. Finally, Rebekah gets pregnant and she delivers twin boys, Jacob and Esau. Now, Esau is born first, but when they are born, Jacob comes out holding on to Esau's heel. Esau is considered the firstborn, the one who will inherit the birthright of his father. But Jacob and his mother, Rebekah, have some other ideas about this. Esau comes in from the field one day for lunch. He's mighty hungry, and he asks Jacob if he'll give him something to eat. Jacob says, okay, I will if you give me your birthright. And Esau says, okay. Now, it makes us wonder a little bit about Esau. We wonder if he didn't hear what Jacob said. Did he think, well, it's not a lasting agreement, it'll just give me lunch for today? We're not sure, but it was the real deal. Jacob now is in line to get all the rights and privileges of the firstborn son. But Jacob and Rebekah have not finished with their tricks. Just before Isaac dies, he asks for Esau to come to him so he can offer words of blessing to him. And Rebekah has Jacob dress in Esau's clothes. And because Isaac is almost blind, he's suspicious. Because the voice doesn't really sound like Esau, it sounds more like Jacob. But he touches the clothes, and they feel like Esau. The clothes smell like Esau. So Isaac gives the words of blessing to Jacob. It's now really a done deal, and it can't be changed. Seems strange to us, doesn't it? Why doesn't Esau run in and say, Dad, take it back, it wasn't me? But that isn't what happens. As you can imagine, Esau is really, really, really mad. And he yells and screams at Jacob and says, just you wait, I'm going to get you for this. Well, that makes Jacob understandably nervous. And his mother tells him to tell his father that he's going to her brother's house to find an acceptable wife. So he heads out on a journey to the home of his uncle. Jacob travels for a day, and then he decides that he needs to stop and rest. And while he sleeps, he has a dream. Now we can imagine that Jacob was scared and lonely and hopefully feeling just a little bit guilty. But God shows up in his dream. Jacob really had no religious expectations of this trip, and yet he has an encounter with God. Old Testament scholar Walter Brueggemann helps us understand the significance. He writes, God comes where God is not anticipated. The center of the text is the speech of God. It is the Lord speaking, and the Lord's speech is a promise. It is a promise for Jacob. God says to Jacob, I am with you. God lets Jacob know that he has not been abandoned. No matter what he's done, God will stand with Jacob. And then God promises, I will keep you. This sounds a bit like the image of the shepherd in the 23rd Psalm who cares for and protects the helpless sheep. The Lord will bless you and keep you. Now, the last part of God's promise to Jacob is about homecoming. Wherever you go, God says, I will bring you back to this land, for I will not leave you until I have done that which I promised you. God promises to Jacob that he can go home again. And when Jacob wakes up, he makes a vow to God. He says, the Lord shall be my God, and I will worship God. I will give all that I am and all that I have to God. Now, this story is a reminder to us that God approves of us. God loves us, no matter what. God has promised to never leave us or forsake us, and that is what undergirds the foundation of this church. The church is a home to us, and God promises that we can always, always come home again. This is the tie that binds us together in love. These connections are what keep us together and keep us in the love of God shown to us in the face of Jesus. We can say with assurance, God is definitely in this place. Now, my time away from you has made me appreciate celebration even more. During the last 6 months, there were experiences that will enrich and inform my work in the days to come. Your giving me this time away was an affirming gift. I felt the connection of your love, and I knew that you would keep on keeping on being the church while I was away. Because of my connection to David, I knew I was leaving you in good hands, and a sabbatical was only possible because you knew and liked David. Time away meant that I could be closer to family, forming a stronger connection of love with them. We connected in ways that aren't possible when you live 1,400 miles away. Terry and I were able to be a part of sporting events of our grandchildren. Our chairs and our blanket were kept in the back of the car at all times. We attended school events. I had an opportunity to teach a calligraphy class for Jonah, our grandson's high school German club. We enjoyed all the graduation events leading up to his graduation on June 15th. Sarah, our daughter, became associate pastor of a church in Redlands, California last November. And so while we were there, we attended her church. It was special to hear her preach and to have her serve us communion. Being a part of her church gave me time to think about celebration, and you were never far from my heart. While visiting another church, I tried to listen more than I talked. There was exposure to new ideas, some I will be sharing with you in the days ahead. But when visiting other churches, there is an occupational hazard, and that is making comparisons with one's own church. One thing that was clear to me is that our music ministry is one of the best. Marcy, Keith, Scott, and our choir set the bar extremely high for other churches, and that was affirmed as I listened to choirs from other churches. The people were kind in the church, but celebration, what I would say to you today, there's not a church anywhere that knows how to extend hospitality like you do. You welcome the stranger. You extend hospitality in a way that makes everyone feel at home. While away, Terry and I each found a place to volunteer, to connect with people we would have never had the opportunity to meet otherwise. I volunteered at a bookstore where all the books are donated and the bookstore is a part of a prison literacy program. Inmates from all over the country can write letters requesting books on particular topics like mysteries, cooking, computers. They are sent two books at a time. Hopefully, the books are on the topics that they request. Some get very specific and it's hard to fill their work. We worked at it. Interwoven in the opportunities for connections were the gentle ways that you kept us connected to celebration. Your notes, your texts, emails, cards, and gifts helped us to know that you were praying for us and holding us close to your heart. These connections brought great joy as we were away. Now, honestly, I must tell you that the weather in California also brought us great joy. But the beauty of the rainstorms that happened all long time in the winter and the snow on the mountain near our house reminded us of the beauty of God's handiwork. As spring slowly came, we were in complete awe at the beauty of the flowers and the trees. We walked among roses laden with blooms and trees heavy with flowers of pink and lavender. There were opportunities to talk with our three grandchildren one-on-one, and these moments brought us great joy. There are moments that I will always treasure. We were filled with awe and thanksgiving at the interesting, intelligent, and kind human beings they have become. Their parents have done a good job with them. Of course, I'm not prejudiced at all. During our time away, there were moments for rest, to read a book for fun. I counted 44 books that I read or listened to in the 6 months we were gone. There was time to go on a walk, to ride my bicycle, to go to a concert, to sit and ponder. I realized that I have difficulty sitting and doing nothing. It takes a conscious effort for me to make it happen. Thank you for giving me time to realize that every minute doesn't have to be filled. We also paid closer attention to justice issues and the need for advocacy in many areas. Hopefully, it will help us live into the words of Dr. King, when you know better, you do better. Other things going on in the world also grabbed our attention. Who would have ever thought that the Southern Baptist Convention would withdraw fellowship from Saddleback Church in California? Their longtime pastor, Rick Warren, was the golden boy of the Baptist about 30 years ago when he wrote the book, some of you have probably read, The Purpose-Driven Life. Pastors were flocking to California to take his class so they could study his ministry and learn from him. But during the pandemic, Rick Warren, he's now retired, but the longtime pastor, the founding pastor of the church, shared that he had carefully studied what Scripture had to say about the leadership of women in the church. He said he realized that in the Great Commission, we were all told to go into the world and preach the gospel. And so he became convinced that women can be called as pastors. And this led him to include pastors who are women on his staff. Well, the SBC decided they must part ways with him because they decided that women cannot teach or preach to men. Now, a statement like that always catches me off guard because there is so much work that needs to be done in the world, and some churches automatically disqualify half the workforce. Doesn't make much sense, does it? But thankfully, God is not disowning anybody. God is not kicking anybody out because God is the God of homecomings. We are always welcome and our joy is renewed when we return home to this family of faith where the foundation is sure, deep, and strong. We are tethered to God and to each other, and what joy this morning to see your smiling faces in person. Beside our front door at home is a plaque that could also be hanging outside our front door here at Celebration. It says this: through the love of God, we extend grace in this place. We welcome strangers. We listen and share. We laugh and cry. We make mistakes. We show mercy. We give thanks. We celebrate life, and we believe in love. We are all family. You see, God's promise to us, as it was to Jacob, is that we can come home again. It's a promise that we can count on. I did.
Please pray with me. God of abundance, sometimes we have to learn how to have faith in the in-between. When there doesn't seem to be enough, show us how your people take care of each other. When we fear to share what we have, show us the grace of receiving an unexpected gift. When we hang on tight for later, just in case, show us that you are in this very moment. In these ways, teach us to give, to share, to offer ourselves for your kingdom work. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you. Because God is a God of homecomings, of bringing us home, we know that this table is for all of us. No one is to be excluded. It's a table where all the chairs needed are provided. So it is a place for each of us to taste of God's love and grace. On that night, Jesus sat with his disciples and he took the bread and he blessed it and he broke it and he gave it to them saying, "This is my body broken for you." And then he took the cup and he said, "This is my blood poured out for the forgiveness of sins." Every time you eat this bread and you drink this cup, remember me. Remember my life. Would those helping with communion please come forward? Please pray with me. God, we thank you that no matter what, that you always call us home to your love and your grace. We thank you for this table that is a constant reminder.
In worship, I wanted to point out something I don't know has been said yet this morning. On the front of your bulletin, the photo that you have of the door is Jorene's front door at her home. And between Jorene and Shannon, they made that very special, and I wasn't sure if anyone else knew that, and so I wanted to make sure you knew as we welcomed Jorene home. A moment of pause to say, you know how much I love my choir and that they are just the best in the whole world, right? And just how privileged between them, and I told Olivia this morning as we were coming in to rehearse, everyone was slowly making their way in for choir rehearsal this morning, and Olivia and Scott are just
what you've been doing the last weeks, and that is hearing from different chairs of our committees, and it is exciting to see the work that the committees are doing. It's been really encouraging. And so Karen is the chair of communications/marketing, right?
Something like that.
Okay.
Thank you, Pastor, and thank you, congregation. I know we all want to get to snacking. So just a few things about communications, marketing and communications. So first I want to introduce you to the group, your folks that are on this committee, Ray Lipinski and Drew Eccles. And I would be remiss if I didn't include Shannon, although she's not officially. We couldn't do what we do without Shannon, so thank you, Shannon. So what do you do on this committee, and what are we looking for? Well, we're looking for people who are creative. If you have a background in some type of marketing or some type of communication, or you just want to get involved in doing this kind of work, our whole purpose is to get the word out about celebration into our LGBTQ plus community, into our near Southside community, and into our greater Fort Worth community, so that fittingly, everyone knows that this is where you will find a home and you'll be welcome here. People need to know that. So part of what we do as well is work on common branding. So we don't have pink over here on one day, red over here on another day, and something like that. If you've noticed our logo, please give thanks to Drew, who came up with that very nice. That allows us to, when people see it, they know that this is Celebration Community Church. One of the other things we've been working on and are still working on, and hopefully we'll wrap up soon, is the redesign of our webpage. Our web pages have always been good, but we can always be better. And so we've been working on who actually goes to our website. Is it the outside world? Is it the inside world? And we're redesigning so we meet those needs. The best thing I can tell you about joining in is the more we are all involved, the more cohesive we become. If you're saying, well, Karen, I really don't want to serve on a committee or anything like that, what can I do? It's very simple. If you're on Facebook, when Shannon posts out the daily devotional or we have an announcement about the church, go right down in the bottom corner where it says share and click on share. And that goes out to people that maybe we aren't having contact with today. Our hashtag for the church, you've seen it, get to know it, use it, is tradition without judgment. Tradition without judgment. That's what everyone says about us. Traditional worship, none of the judgment. So we would welcome you to come and get involved with our committee, either informally or formally, because we need creativity and we need your energy. There's so much to do. We have North Texas Giving Day coming up. We've got videos to do, Pastor, so start getting ready. There are just so many creative ways we can and should be reaching out so that all people know they're welcome here. I'll leave you with this one thing, and I hope it means something to you. Celebration has a story to tell. We give it a voice. Thank you.
I used to say that Fort Worth was the best kept secret in Texas. Somehow the word's gotten out, right? They're all coming. But we don't want celebration to be the best kept secret in Fort Worth. We wanted people to know about our worship and about what they can experience here, the home that they can find here. And so I'm going to give the benediction, and I'm going to head out to the Fellowship Hall. I hope you will come to the Fellowship Hall as well. Through the love of God, we extend grace in this place. We welcome strangers. We listen. We share. We laugh. We cry. We make mistakes. We extend mercy. We give thanks. We celebrate life. We believe in love. This is our home, and we are family. Thanks be to God.